The fossil record provides evidence of how creatures change over time, millions and millions of years. However, time has not changed how the fossil record is found.
The way we find dinosaurs is the same way we have for centuries. We get out, we walk around on the ground, and we look. We put our eyes to the ground and look for fossils sticking out. So as you're walking around, sometimes for days, sometimes for weeks, and not finding anything in the heat and in the rain.
This side?
Yeah, right in there.
Sure.
You never know when you're going to turn that hill and you're going to find something incredible, and it keeps you going every single day.
And in the dry, barren Cedar Mountain formation of central Utah, Dr. Lindsay Zanno has discovered incredible creatures that lived long ago.
You know, you have to understand your past, understand where you're going. We live on a dynamic planet. It's changing. We want to know what it's going to be like in the future and what we should do about it and what we should protect and how to fit in with our own ecosystems. The best record we have of that is the evolution of life on the planet. It's 4 billion years of actual data.
There's a rich story to be told about this area. It resembles a moonscape now, but fossils reveal the landscape was once the lush and wet coastline of the continent. It was filled with dense vegetation and a variety of reptiles, amphibians, and dinosaurs. Radiometric dating of volcanic rock found here sets that time between 100 million and 60 million years ago. Not much is known about the creatures that lived in this age of Earth's history, and almost every discovery is new to science.
And this animal was living right along the coast, sort of a beach bum, if you will, in the late Cretaceous.
Dr. Zanno hopes to introduce this new species of duck-billed dinosaur to the world this year. She estimates the creature lived about 78 million years ago. It was about 25 feet long and stood about 20 feet tall.
But it's a gorgeous specimen. Its eye would have been here. It has a large humped nose.
That humped nose looked a lot like a bird beak. The brown material you're looking at is fossilized bone. The gray material in between is sandstone.
So they had a bill and a beak at the front of the face here, and then a bunch of grinding teeth toward the back of the jaw.
The creature was a plant eater, and it had plenty of teeth.
And in fact had dental batteries of hundreds to possibly 1,000 teeth in each individual that were continuously replacing as they lived. So they ate horrible stuff. They ate pine cones and bark and pine needles and these sorts of things, and they ground their teeth down, but they could continuously replace them.
Think of paleontology as a kind of prehistoric forensics. Scientists look for clues that reveal not only how an animal lived, but also what happened to it when it died. They ask questions such as, was it scavenged upon? Did it lay in the sun? Was it buried quickly before its soft tissue decomposed? The answers reveal what the ecosystem and the environment was like where the dinosaur lived and died. To make sure all of that information is recovered, researchers leave the fossils encased in the sediment they were buried in. They wrap everything in a protective plaster shell and bring it all back to the lab for study.
So this animal died and was buried in a river. It was probably buried fairly quickly, but it had a chance for some of its soft tissue to decompose.
Most of the duck-billed dinosaur's skeleton was discovered. This is a bone from the top of the vertebrae. This is a toe bone. This bone made the tip of the tail. These are its ribs. So, fleck by fleck, at the point of a sharp tool, or the bristle of a brush, or the whir of an air drill, bone is uncovered. The dinosaur's story is told. Paleontology is a study in time and patience. And at the North Carolina Museum of Science, volunteers are trained to help scientists discover the fossil story. Ashley Biscoe is uncovering a prehistoric turtle.
And right now I'm kind of chiseling away piece by piece a little bit at some of the matrix and revealing what we have there. And because it is so fragile and falling apart, I'm having to go in and consolidate, make sure the bone stays together where it's at so we can get a better idea of what it actually looks like.
This is a femur from a falcarius, which is about 125 million years old. So this is the bottom part, and that's in the middle. It goes like that, and this will fit on the top. And because of the size of this, we think this one is relatively young. So I'm kind of working on maybe a teenager. This is about 125 million years old, and the thrill of it is to be able to touch and feel something that's 125 million years old. It's just amazing.
It can take 3 to 5 years or more to recover a fossil in the field and then bring the specimens back to the lab, where the sediment is removed and the bones are studied. But what a story the fossils can tell.
But this specimen right here has bite marks on it. And so some of these animals were definitely being eaten, whether or not they were killed and then eaten, or if they died and were scavenged. It's hard to tell, but there's definitely evidence that something was gnawing on this bone. If you can look right here, you can see there's two holes right here. Those are bite marks on this particular bone.
And each bone fragment tells a story that fills in just a bit more with a mosaic of the picture of Earth's history.
It is hard to wrap your head around those kinds of timescales, but we have to work in that kind of dimension, and it's hard for us even to grasp that. But when you look at, sometimes we'll have a table that'll have fossils on it that are 100 million years of time, but each time we dig one up, it's just a tiny little piece of that puzzle that allows us to fill in those big gaps, and so we get better at understanding that.